Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to the fourth Sunday, the last Sunday in Advent, and it is the Sunday of love. And what can I say? I know that God loves me no matter how stupid I can be made. I know that He loves all of us, whether we deserve it or not, because chances are we don't deserve His love. But He loves us anyway. Any joys or concerns? Yes, no.
I'd like to pray to keep Ruthie and David in your prayers. And David had a fall last night, and he is in surgery right now. But they seem to think, you know, things will be all right. So we can keep him in the prayers. And I know you all see that I still have the stuff out here in the feds down at home. Well, they have a breakout of COVID. I think there's 8 or 10 of them that have had it right now. So, needless to say, I'm not going down there. It'll be after Christmas.
That's okay.
Sure. And I won't go until I feel like it's safe to go.
And we're so glad that, I mean, it's a blessing to them that you're doing this for them, but it's a blessing for all of us that you are wise enough not to take chances.
Oh, it's a blessing for all that this church does for them, and they do so appreciate it. And I'm still praying that come January we'll be able to help some more people, and events is supposed to, if. Yeah, you know, I'm dealing with Patty. Patty's like me. Nope, not going to happen.
Right.
So, we're doing that. And, of course, as always, just keep anybody and everybody that is suffering mentally, physically, however, health-wise, in your prayers, because this is a difficult time
for a lot of people. You're right. And we certainly, there are lots of people that we do need to remember. I know my cousin who just lost her husband right before Thanksgiving is still having a hard time, and I can't imagine. So keep those that are hurting spiritually, solely, physically, just, dear Lord, let hold on to them and let them feel your love. That's all we can do. And thank you for keeping us updated on Ruth and David and also on the deaths. Are there any others?
I have a few other notes. First of all, for God's stuff, yesterday, we gave away a ton of food, which is wonderful. There's still some bread back here, and milk. We have, about, I don't know, 200-300 little milks upstairs. If you would like some milk, please go upstairs at the church and get you some milk. We need to get that out. But it's good until some of it next week, some of it early January.
Wow.
Food baskets. We've got all kinds of stuff up here for the food baskets. We are still collecting those little extras. Remember, the food pantry said this month, take care of your food baskets. Next month, we'll start for them again. So we're looking for eggs, butter, bacon, and dish detergent. And you can put the eggs, butter, and bacon in the parlor kitchen. I have a concern. One of my cousins who lives out in St. Louis has pancreatic cancer, and I'd like you to keep Barb in your prayers. Not only is she dealing with cancer and the chemotherapy and things like that, her son, 27-year-old son, was killed in a car accident in Kansas City. So if you would also keep Michael's family, cousins and aunts and uncles and parents, in your prayers. And speaking of that, and Sue kind of alluded to this, and Carrie will probably mention this too, we have a blue Christmas service this evening at 6 o'clock. I have a friend who lost his 40-year-old son. Today is his son's 40th birthday. He lost him a few months ago. I have a friend who just lost her husband and mother in the last few months. So if we could keep all of the people in our hearts that are grieving at this time.
Thanks. Are there any other joys, concerns? All right. We have our candle light.
God's love is like an open door.
God's love is the street light that guides us home.
God's love is a warm bed to fall into.
God's love is a table with room for you.
God's love is a crackling fireplace.
God's love is the sun that streams through the windows.
God's love is the roof over our heads and the floor beneath our feet.
God's love is a home for you and me, for neighbors and strangers, for family and friends, for enemies and partners.
God's love is a home for all.
Today we light the candle of love to remind us of this truth.
May it burn brightly in this space and even brighter in our hearts.
Amen.
We are seeking deep within the faith, a place to belong, the feeling that God is here in this room.
We are seeking
joy that overflows, the movement of the Spirit, a hand to hold, and a love under the dark.
We are seeking
the freedom to be, the courage to love, the conviction to act in the face of injustice.
We are seeking, but here this space,
where we found.
Take deep breath. This is your sanctuary.
God is here. We are found. Amen.
God of grace, you chose the Virgin Mary, full of grace, to be the mother of our Lord and Savior. Now fill us with your grace, that with her we may rejoice in your salvation and in all things embrace your will. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Amen.
And 121.
Yeah.
miss the person standing on our doorstep, even if we fail to care for ourselves the way God would care for us, even if we forget and ignore, turn away, and shut down, God still loves us. There is nothing we can do to lose God's love.
Rescue is promised.
If we get lost,
we will be found.
If we mess up,
we are forgiven.
If we withhold love,
God is lavishing love on us.
We are claimed, we are loved, we are forgiven.
Thanks be to God. Amen.
Jesus, joy the highest heaven, born in the Bell.
So today we're talking about Mary in the scripture lesson when she found out that she was pregnant with Jesus.
Yeah, she was
going to be the king of Bethlehem. That's right. And when the angel came to tell Mary that she was pregnant, she went and went to her cousin Elizabeth's house and stayed there for several months. And when Mary entered Elizabeth's house, Elizabeth was pregnant too with John the Baptist, and the baby leaped inside her because apparently that unborn baby knew that Jesus was the Savior. It was Jesus. So Mary needed a safe place to go, and she went to her cousin Elizabeth's house. That's right. Do you know why? Because Mary wasn't. So she probably was nervous. Do you think she was nervous? Do you think she was happy?
Yeah.
Do you think she was excited?
Yeah.
She's going to have a baby. But it's important to have a place where you feel safe and understood, isn't it? So the good news is that we have a safe place with God, and we can be a safe place for other people when we listen to what they need and what they care and take care of them, like Elizabeth did for Mary. There's poinsettias over there. There's a statue. There's a statue over there. Yeah.
What is that picture?
Well, who knows? I'm new here. Is that Mary and Joseph and the baby in the bottom and the angel above them? Okay. Yeah. You see those people on the bottom? They have baby Jesus. Yeah, no, Jesus isn't over there yet, is he? He'll be over there on Friday when we have Christmas Eve. The day before Christmas, when Santa comes.
I'm only going to be 7 after.
All right, so let's say a prayer. Dear God, thank you for the places where we are safe, cared for, and understood. Watch over the people who aren't in a safe place right now, and help us to be that safe place for others. Amen.
Yeah, my birthday is on 7 days before. My birthday is after 7 days.
After 7 days. Blessed is she who believed that there would be a fulfillment of what was spoken to her by the Lord. And Mary said, my soul magnifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God my Savior. For he has looked with favor on the lowliness of his servant. Surely from now on, all generations will call me blessed, for the mighty one has done great things for me, and holy is his name. His mercy is for those who fear him from generation to generation. He has shown strength with his arm. He has scattered the proud in the thoughts of their hearts. He has brought down the powerful from their thrones and lifted up the lowly. He has filled the hungry with good things and sent the rich away empty. He has helped his servant Israel in response, in remembrance of his mercy, according to the promise he made to our ancestors, to Abraham, and to his descendants forever. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Let us pray. Open us, Holy One, to your word and your way. As we make our final preparations before Christmas, clear our minds of holiday distractions and our long list of to-dos. Help us approach your word with awe and wonder so that we may hear the message you intend for us today. Amen. Theologian Tom Long tells a story of a game he played as a child with the other children in his neighborhood on rainy afternoons. It was a game of the imagination. It didn't have a name, but he says if it did have a name, it would have been called Where Would You Leave the Treasure? The idea was this, he says. Suppose you had a large amount of money, a treasure really, but some unexpected crisis has come up and suddenly you have to leave the treasure with someone for safekeeping. You can't put it in the bank or bury it under the oak tree in the backyard. There isn't time. The rule of the game is that you have to entrust it to someone, some human being. Whom would you choose? The fun of the game, of course, was sitting around in a circle and exploring all the character flaws and virtues of the various possibilities, searching for a trustworthy person. How about the school principal, one child would suggest. Nah, you'd probably steal it. Well, how about the preacher? Too risky. He'd probably put it in the collection plate. Okay, then, what about your sister? Are you kidding? She'd want to split it. And on it would go, the search for just the right person to keep the treasure. In the mind of a child, the stakes were high. Your whole treasure risked on something as fragile as the trustworthiness of another human being. Tom imagines that what God did was a divine version of his childhood game, Where Would You Leave the Treasure? God was searching for a human being to leave the treasure, the good news in the form of a baby. And Mary was his chosen human. But why Mary? Mary was probably somewhere between the age of 13 and 16, and her family was not part of any important family. In fact, her family was probably pretty poor. Certainly not the type of human that would immediately come to mind as the keeper of the world's greatest treasure. And chances are, that is what Mary thought as well. Luke tells us a story of where God decided to leave the treasure, and it's a story that gives us an example of trust and faithful discipleship. Our scripture today takes us to the home of Zechariah and Elizabeth, where the child Mary comes to spend some time. We aren't told why Mary comes to spend 3 months here, but we can definitely speculate that perhaps her parents sent her to her cousin Elizabeth's home to wait out the pregnancy, since her life would have been in danger. It was a place of sanctuary for her, a safe place, away from the prying eyes of nosy neighbors and those who may have wanted to harm her for her indiscretion. Mary is called on to believe in the impossible. She is called to trust in a message far more complex than anything we can imagine. This is the old, old story of God's steadfast covenant that she will not make this journey alone. God will be with her. So she goes to Elizabeth's house, flees to Elizabeth's house, baby. And what does she do? She sings. The Magnificat is one of the most beautiful scriptures in the Bible. I have had the privilege to sing this piece of music several times. Even though Mary's situation is not good, she is very young, pregnant, and unwed, and not protected from the harsh reality of her culture. She sings of hope and God's glory, and her words are revolutionary. She begins with the declaration, "From now on." Mary recognizes that a turning point has to happen for the world to change. She declares this as the moment. From now on, all generations will be blessed. They will no longer bear the chains the old system created, empty works, meaningless sacrifices, and dread over falling short. From now on, the ones who have amassed power will be humbled and scattered. From now on, things worth striving for are humbleness, servanthood, mercy. These are words of a revolutionary dreaming up a world that is entirely different than the reality. The situation is not good yet, but the future is looking good. I think we can relate to Mary's situation and her song, maybe more so this year than in previous years, when we consider that her situation was not good yet. And what about our situation? Here we are facing the second holiday season under the shadow of COVID. We find ourselves longing still for a return to the life we were living pre-pandemic. It's getting to a point now of almost feeling nostalgic for a time when we didn't have to pay attention to crowds, and whether our allergy symptoms are simply allergies or something more. And in these 20 or so months that we have had to deal with this disease, there have been plenty of other issues that have taken up our news channels. The difference between essential workers and, well, what is the term for the opposite of essential worker? Unessential? The divide between people of color and white people, and the ever-increasing divide between the haves and the have-nots. We long for the good old days, but what we really need to be thinking about is what are the lessons that we are learning during this time. We are not going to return to what was. We are looking at a new normal, something that is better, fairer, less wasteful, even maybe more contemplative. Maybe God has been at work through the disruption of the pandemic, forcing us to live more intentionally, humanely, generously, kindly. Maybe, just maybe, the home we long to return to is a place we've never been to before. As the prophet Isaiah said, "Behold, I am doing a new thing, something updated and improved." Jesus turned the world upside down when he walked among us. And that is the world that we are still trying to achieve. Our situation is not good yet. But like Mary, we need to trust that God has our back. Mary urges us to look to God, to dream of a future that is so unlike the one we are in now, and do what we can to hold on. Luke's word to us this day is that God hears our prayers, even in times of hopelessness and helplessness. That treasure that God entrusted to Mary will lift up the lowly and fill the hungry with good things, setting all things right. On a dark night in a feed stall in Bethlehem, the treasure became a treasure for all of us. Amen. Amen. Same number 99.
Thank you.
Receiving of our tithes and offerings, Elizabeth offers her home. She offers her arms. She offers her joy. She offers her affirmation and confidence. Elizabeth offers everything she has when Mary shows up at her door. And it just feels holy, doesn't it? Part of our call as people of faith is to give when and where we can. So today, you are invited to be a little bit more like Elizabeth. Today, we are invited to give generously, trusting that God will take care of these gifts and build a better world here. So let us give with joyful hearts.
Merry Christmas, everybody!
Merry Christmas!